Thank you. So we move on to the last speaker of the day, Professor S. Krishnaswamy, who's from Madras and will talk about the Madras connection. He's currently a visiting professor at the Institute of Mathematical Sciences in our computational biology group. He did his PhD here at the University of Madras. He did all of his undergraduate education, school education in Madras as well, which is why he calls it the Madras connection and not the Chennai connection. He moved out a long time ago. After doing his PhD, he was in Purdue and then in France, in Strasbourg. And after that, he moved to Madurai Kamarajar University, where he was the coordinator for the Center for Excellence in Bioinformatics. He built a unit which studies the structure of biological molecules. So a lot of us have very regimented ideas about science. We have physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics. Professor Krishnaswamy is one person who works at the confluence of all of these. I think he studied physics, his PhD is in physics, but he uses mathematical ideas developed in physical context to study chemical molecules that work in biological systems, so something to that effect. So he will tell us something about that shortly. He has been working intensely for in the field of science popularization. He's been trying to take scientific ideas and to propagate them among the general public. So he has been the president for the Tamil Nadu Science Federation, TNSF, for two terms. The Tamil Nadu Science Federation does a lot of work trying to popularize science. They bring out two magazines for children, Thulir in Tamil and Jantar Mantar in English. They also bring out Vignana Chiragu, a Tamil newsletter expressing scientific viewpoints. On that note, let me hand over the mic to him. So Professor Krishnaswamy will talk about molecular structures with the Madras connections.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for the opportunity. And we've just been on a wonderful trip to the stars and back. So please join me for a short sightseeing tour of the wonderful world within us of molecules. So I hope we can go through. First, I'll take you through some molecules and structures, and then go on to a bit of a historical perspective about how molecular structures are seen, determined. And then we'll short for a brief while and adore and look at and how a group from Madras University at the Department of Crystallography and Biophysics here, led by Professor G. N. Ramachandran, was able to place Madras on the map of the structural world by coming up with a conceptual leap of imagination about this collagen structure, and then also came up with a method which till today stands the test of time, and people have to pass their structures through this in order to be accepted. And then we move on to looking at some structures and what we can learn from structures. And then finally wrap it up all with coming back to JNR and then saying about where we are and what next. So with that, let's, like Alice, jump down into this rabbit hole and go down. And what happened is about 150 years ago, many of you will be familiar that Darwin came up with this concept of the tree of life, which connected, in his perspective, connected things that existed then and things which existed in the past. And now we know, thanks to people like Uma Ramakrishnan, who do this lot of sequencing and genetic work, we know now that this is very much true. And in fact, life, all of biological life on Earth is related evolutionarily, and we can broadly classify into three domains of life called the bacteria, the archaea, and the eukarya. So I have purposely shifted the tree of life upside down just to show that humans are not, as we think, the pinnacle of evolution. There is no pinnacle, there is no mountain. And what you see is our famous MS Subbalakshmi out there in the proper branch where it belongs to human. And then you also have this butterfly or this palm tree, which is a symbol of Tamil Nadu. All these three belong to eukarya. But Feynman, Richard Feynman, a famous physicist, once remarked that we are but a bag of molecules. So in fact, it's a bag of molecules walking up and down here, talking to bags of molecules out there. No? But then it seems so silly to think of that. But I like the view, because you see, when you start thinking of people, including M.S. Subbalakshmi or the butterfly or the palm tree, as bags of molecules, especially humans as bags of molecules, it seems so silly and idiotic to be able to start differentiating and discriminating them based on caste, religion, gender, and even wealth for that matter. So, you see, it's good to think of bags of molecules. I think we go on and look at the molecules, how they are made. They are made by atoms, especially atoms, hydrogen, carbon, oxygen. And as Yashwant was telling us about the exoplanets, if there is biological life on the exoplanets, it's going to be made of only atoms, hydrogen, carbon, oxygen. Maybe they will be linked together to form different types of molecules than what exist here. But they will be linked by things which we call covalent bonds, which is how two atoms are linked to form molecules. And if you look at this life on Earth, which we have, these are the sort of molecules which we see on the end: water, glucose, sugar, lipid, amino acid. These are all small molecules. Of course, water is the most ubiquitous of them all. It is there everywhere. These small molecules are joined together to form these big molecules called macromolecules. Nucleic acids, you are familiar with, DNA, proteins, carbohydrates. These are all formed from chains of these small molecules. What is interesting is that if you look through these macromolecules, they show the underlying unity and diversity which I mentioned earlier. If you look at the way the nucleic acids are used, DNA is used to make protein, that machinery is common across all the domains of life. If you look at how proteins all interconnect with each other, interact with each other, form these big networks to create pathways, to do certain processes which are basic to cellular life, again that is common between all three domains of life. And if you look at the languages, just as I am speaking English or maybe sometimes Tamil, just as these languages, molecules also have languages. For example, the genetic code, which says the gene codes for a protein, that is a language. How the protein structure is formed from the sequence of the amino acids, that is a language. And then how molecules interact and talk to each other through physical chemical forces, that is yet another language. But beauty is, all these languages are again so similar across all the domains of life that makes you really see that we are nothing but bags of molecules. And just to give you an idea, what is this distance we are talking about the molecules? These molecules are not huge, not like you and me. They are very small. They are about an angstrom, because that's the dimension of the bond. Typically, water is about 2.8 angstrom, or tropocollagen, which you will be seeing later, is about 3,000 angstroms or more. But then, what is this angstrom? The angstrom is like what, you know, Amri told us, that 10 power 8, that is 10 multiplied 8 times, that is 10, you have these 7 zeros, but that doesn't make any sense, no? 10 power 8 angstrom is 1 centimeter, so what? What does it mean? To give you an idea of what it is, I've just made this thing. You can see here that if I put the palm of my hand and ask how many such palms fit into the Earth's diameter, that's about 10 power 8. Or to make it better, you imagine shrinking the world into the palm of your hand. No, there's this metaphor, the world is in your hand, which is your mobile. So if you shrink the Earth to your palm, then a centimeter becomes an angstrom, and your mobile phone will be like a sugar molecule. That's about the size of it. So you see, we are talking about very small little fellows. And then what happens to these small little fellows? Is it that the cell is all full and empty like what you see in the textbooks? No. Look at this one. This is a mycoplasma, mycoid cell, a beautiful illustration of it drawn by a person called David Goodsell, who himself is a scientist. So scientists do a lot of other things other than doing science also. So this is a diagram which shows how molecules are arranged inside the cell. You can see it's jam-packed. No, it's like going to Ranganathan Street in Chennai, or a marketplace. But even if you go to a crowded marketplace, you are able to do what you want, maneuver all over, get your job done. Same thing happens with molecules. Every minute, every second, molecules are able to maneuver into this crowd. They don't have a mind of their own. They do it by thermal motion, random motion, and of course, aided by their physical chemical interactions. These physico-chemical interactions, I won't go into them. Already we talked about this covalent bond, which is a strong interaction. There are other type of interaction called a medium interaction or hydrogen bond, which just keep it in mind. We'll come across this again when we talk about the collagen structure and other structures. And then there are these weak interactions, which I won't go into in detail. Since we are going to be talking about molecules, let's see how molecules can be represented. We can, of course, represent them by the wireframe or the ball and stick, where every atom is made a ball, and then the stick gives you the bonds. The more interesting stuff is what is called the space-filling model. This model is as if how one molecule perceives the other molecule. It's like saying that it's a personal space of a molecule. All of you are familiar. No? You go on a bus, you feel a little uncomfortable when people come too close to you. And in some other places, you don't mind the squeeze. Something similar happens here. This space-filling diagram gives you an idea about how molecules perceive each other. And we'll be seeing this, of course, a little more diagrammatic versions of these later. So and most of the talk will be on proteins. So I'll just let you know what are these proteins. They are basically of three types. One which is called soluble, like hemoglobin, that is a molecule that carries blood, oxygen from your blood, from your lungs through the blood to the tissues and takes carbon dioxide back and leaves it to the lungs. It's globular because it's like oil drop in water, it forms a little globule. Then the other one called membrane protein. This protein sits on the membrane. There are many such membrane proteins. They sit on the membrane because that is a membrane is the interface between the outside of the cell and the inside of the cell. This particular example, for example, porin is a molecule that sits and behaves like a gatekeeper of the cell, allowing molecules to pass through or not. And then we have fibrous proteins, which are structural proteins. And an example is the hero of the day, the molecule of the day, collagen. This again, a fibrous protein. So these are three basic types of proteins. We'll be seeing a bit of the fibrous proteins and a bit of the soluble proteins, and I'll just tell you a taste of the membrane protein at the end. So how are these proteins formed? They are formed by amino acids joining together using a covalent bond called a peptide bond. A peptide bond is a covalent bond. It's just a different name given to it that joins these two amino acids. And you can see the amino acid, there's an R that is written. That is what is called the side chain. That it can be occupied by hydrogen. It can be occupied by many different atoms. We will see later there are different amino acids with different side chains. And then this, apart from the side chain, the other atoms form what is called the backbone or the main chain. So just to keep in mind later for this. This is the 20 different amino acids that are there in all of life. And all our proteins are different combinations of these. I just draw your attention to this one which is circled, that's called glycine. This is the smallest amino acid because this glycine will come again in the collagen structure when you look at it. So now what happens to all these different proteins? They form different shapes and sizes. You can see variety of proteins having different shapes and sizes, just like you and me. No? It amazes me always when I tell in class about this famous song by Kannadasan. No? Paravaigal palavidam, ovvondrum oruvidam. There are many different birds, each of a different variety. Same thing happens in molecules. Many different, each looking different. And why do they look different? Because they need this structure to perform their function. One example is shown here, that is of a protein called topoisomerase, which has a hole in the middle, and the DNA passes through this hole. So this protein is used to unwind the DNA. Unless the DNA is unwound, the DNA cannot be read by other proteins to make more proteins. It's like a chicken and egg problem. But this unwinding is done by this protein, which looks like a pipe wrench, really. No? Only thing is, a pipe wrench does it mechanically. Here, inside, there's a chemical reaction that takes place, which breaks the bond so that the DNA can be separated. So point is, how do you know all these structures? For that, if we have a very tiny, tiny thing, then we can put it in the microscope and look at it, because the light will be scattered, the object will scatter the light, and then you have a lens that can refocus, and we can look at the small object in a big way. But the problem is, for X-rays, for molecules, we don't have lenses which can focus the X-rays. So what happens is, we shine X-rays on a crystal, which is a row of molecules, something like the row of seats which are here. Imagine on every seat, one particular molecule, the same molecule sitting all through. That's like a crystal. Or a fiber where the molecules are arranged in one direction, repeated in one direction. Because they are repeated, they all sort of shout the same time, scatter at the same time, and give you an amplification. So you find that you get a diffraction. It's called diffraction because you have these atoms which are about an angstrom apart. You have these X-rays which are about an angstrom in wavelength. Because the distance of separation and the wavelength are similar, they not only scatter, the scattered lights interfere, like your colors of the rainbow which you see in your puddles. When it rains, oil is there. Some sort of similar thing happens. You get this and you get a diffraction, which is nothing but a series of spots which have varying intensity brightness in them. So now the question is, from these spots, how do you find out the structure? That is like a puzzle. And because we don't have a lens, we use human beings, mathematics, and calculating devices. And nowadays, you have these computers which combines all these things so that you don't really need anybody. You can just shove your crystal into the X-ray, get the diffraction data, and get the structure, provided it is a simple small molecule. But if it's a big molecule, then it's still problematic, and you need human intervention. That's how crystallographers continue to be in business. So now, once you have this diffraction data, it's a question of finding out what is the arrangement of atoms which can give you back the same diffraction image. So that is what is done, and you get a model of the structure that is made. So once you have such a thing, obviously people would want to find out how to determine structure. And the first crystal structure that was done was just after 1912, when von Laue showed that if you put a crystal in an X-ray beam, it will diffract. So immediately within a year, Bragg, Lawrence Bragg and his father Henry Bragg, they put this salt crystal and determined the structure of the salt crystal. You see, salt is very important. About 27 years after this, we know salt was used by one of our people to overthrow the government. So it's very political also in nature. So the salt structure is now taken as granted. And that's the beauty of science. What we now take as granted is not taken as granted many years ago. Science builds up on itself. It's not like religion, where the knowledge is static. And that's why I like science. Because science is like you're standing on a moving ship. It's much more fun, interesting, things change, you learn more, and it builds up on an edifice like that. And that Bragg not only did this, they also determined the structure of diamond, which is shown here at the left bottom. You can see it's like one of those fruit stall displays you see where people are selling fruits. It's a packed arrangement which is seen here. And not only they did this, they also came up with a geometrical method to explain what X-ray diffraction is. So for that, they got the Nobel Prize, the father and son duo, the first time, and I think the only time father and son have got this. There are many others involved, but I would just like to focus on a very good human being and scientist, and that is Dorothy Hodgkin, who took to crystallography, who took to looking at molecules and structures using X-rays because of a book she read when she was in school, which was written by Bragg. She got so enthusiastic with that, that she got into this, and she worked with the lab of J.D. Purnell, a father figure in all this molecular structural world in Cambridge in UK. And then just before the war, World War II, she solved the structure of penicillin, and then after the war, she solved the structure of vitamin B12, which is a coenzyme, which is an important molecule. And for that, she got a Nobel Prize in 64, but she didn't stop after that. She continued to work. That was her primary interest, was working on insulin. So she has started working on insulin in 34, and about 35 years later, she determined the structure of insulin. So we'll see that more later. So, okay, now these crystals are very difficult to make. So there were people working on crystals, but they were not getting anywhere with all the protein structures. You couldn't get the structure because the crystals either didn't diffract properly or they diffracted, but you couldn't determine the atom positions from that. So fibers were easier to handle and people were working in fibers. And then Pauling, who was in the US, came for a visit to London, UK, Cambridge, where he happened to see the X-ray diffraction pictures taken by Astbury of a human hair. And so then he realized that this human hair, you can fit a model to that, and that model came to be called the alpha helix. What is shown here, what I've tried to show there, is those two arrows, where you can see the top small little smiling arcs. That arc, which is called the meridional reflection, that gives information about how things are repeating in this direction, in the fiber direction. So with only that information and using models, he came up with this idea of a right-handed alpha helix, where you can see what is shown on that bar on the side, that is a turn, one turn of a helix that contains what he said is 3.6 residues. That was a very revolutionary. People were trying to fix this. They all came up with 2, 3. Finally, he said there's a non-integral number, meaning that if I take 10 turns, then there are 36 residues. So this is a conceptual leap at that time of saying there's a non-integral number of residues and this is a right-handed helix. The story goes that Pauling came over, saw this, fell ill, and when he was ill, he was playing with paper clips, and that's when he came up with the idea. You don't know whether the story is true or not, but it just shows that science, scientists do science all the time, whether they are sick, whether they are brewing coffee or cooking at home, it doesn't matter. Science is there every minute of the day, a scientist does work. And that's what is interesting for people to come to science. Now, not only was Pauling a good scientist, but he also took up social causes, like the one protest against nuclear weapons. And for that, he got a Nobel Prize, apart from the Nobel Prize in chemistry. So he's the only person who's got a Nobel Prize in science as well as for peace. And then we know the famous double helical Watson and Crick DNA story, that this fiber diffraction photograph taken by Rosalind Franklin and Morris Wilkins, people could not interpret. Watson and Crick managed to interpret this using models and came up with this famous double helical. Just to show you that the corner, you have this pink strand and the green strand. They are going around in a right-handed fashion, but they are opposite to each other. One goes this way, the other goes opposite. And there is also, they propose that they are held together by inter-strand hydrogen bonds. So Pauling had said, along the strand there's a hydrogen bond. These people said, between the strands there is a hydrogen bond. So this was the state in 1953, when the world was full of a lot of interesting stuff going on. On the one hand, Pauling, 51 alpha helix, 53 Watson and Crick DNA. And what is happening in India is that we have this group by G.N. Ramachandran and others in Madras University. How did this happen? A visionary vice chancellor by the name of Lakshminarayana Mudaliar, he invited Sir C.V. Raman to come and head the Department of Physics in Madras University because he realized that there's a lot that can be done with physics at that time. And because C.V. Raman was already busy with Raman Research Institute, he said, look, I'm old. I'll send you a younger guy who's better than me. And he sent G.N. Ramachandran. There's a lot of stories about G.N. Ramachandran, which you can, now I don't have the time, you can look it up. There's a very nice documentary called The Immortal Coils, and it's available on YouTube. It's made by CSIR, surprisingly. And that's because the DG of CSIR, who happened to make it, was fascinated by G.N. Ramachandran, and so he felt it should be done. And now, if you, one of the important thing is that you can see G.N. Ramachandran there, G. Karta, the main player, who a postdoctoral worker, postdoctoral fellow with Ramachandran, who determined the structure of collagen. Ambadi on the top, who did the fiber diffraction data, who made the fiber diffraction. And Sashi Shekhar, who is shown at the side, who, as we will see later, worked on this Ramachandran plot. Incidentally, the person next to Karta, whom I have not marked, is Aladi Ramakrishnan, who started the Institute of Mathematical Sciences. And you see this, in 52, Ramachandran came and started this department in Madras University. We'll just listen to the thing in Ramachandran's own voice. You can see that. Just give me a minute.
This laboratory, the appointment in Madras was rather unique for anybody in India at that time. Namely, that the department had reasonable amount and no previous equipment was there and no previous heritage was there, so that I could develop it just as I liked.
See, he developed it just as he liked. And what did you do? What would you do if you're just going to start a department, you're getting equipment ready, you're getting all the X-ray machines done, and people are just getting settled in? What would anyone do? You try to take a safe and simple problem. But no, not GNR. What he did was, he went and took up the structure of collagen, which was a leap in the dark, in his own words, later. And how did he happen to do it? Because at that time, J.D. Bernal, whom we mentioned earlier, came to visit Madras University. And then he took Ramachandran aside and very confidentially told him, hey, look, they are not getting anywhere with the structure of collagen. DNA is already done. Alpha helix is done. You take up collagen and you can do it well. And so Ramachandran immediately went to the Department of Biochemistry, got some collagen from them and started trying to do it. But there was a lot of some contamination was there, so he didn't get anywhere. Then he went to Naidamma, who had just come back from the US and had taken up deputy directorship in CLRA, which was next door. And he told Naidamma, look, the best collagen people are reporting is from kangaroo tail. Where can you get kangaroo tail in Tamil Nadu or Madras? And then Naidamma just kept quiet. And 3 weeks later or 2 weeks later, apparently Naidamma gave him a full tube of collagen from kangaroo tail tendon. And so G.N. Ramachandran immediately put his best experimentalist, Ambadi, on the job. And Ambadi produced this beautiful figure. Of course, he made many other such figures of X-ray diffraction from stretched collagen. And if you just take that figure, which looks like a joker with a face, the cap and the beard, the little goatee at the bottom, these two are the traits which told that there are two repeated helices, two type of repeats. One which seems to happen many times, that's why it gets very bright and dark. The other which happens not so many times, that's why it's faint at the bottom. So he then came up with this leap of idea that it is three helices which are coiled around each other. This one helix is called the minor helix, which is going in a left-handed manner. And then these three together form a right-handed. And this people had not gotten earlier. Crick was working on this. Pauling was working on this. None of them, Crick and, had a model where three coils were running parallel to each other. And it was GNR's original idea that it is the coiled coil which can interpret this data. And then that he published in this thing, and you have the model of collagen which is here. You can see on the right side extreme, you have this black helix going this way. And you can see that there are three. This pointer doesn't come out, yeah. So you can see that this turn goes like this. There are 10 residues on these three turns. And then this whole helix goes like this. So if I take from this turn, this one turn contains, like that, there are, if you take three such turns, they will contain 30 residues, right? So that is the major helix, which is having 30 residues in three turns. And then the minor helix, which is the black helix, here, which is going in a left-handed manner, where one, there are, if you take this turn, this one turn, so like that, 10 residues are there in three turns, which means one turn will have 3.3 residues, a non-integral number of residues. And then you can also see that what he proposes, these strands, these are held together by interstrand hydrogen bonding. And you can see here a view down the helix, this position 1 and position 4, these are glycine, because the glycine is the smallest one and it will not come into clash with this. So when I rotate, it goes not exactly on top because there is a small twist. So that goes as the fourth position here. So he was able to show that the collagen is a coiled coil made of three coils. The three are left-handed and these three twist together to form a right-handed thing, something like the braid, which is there when people braid their hair, something similar is present. And what is interesting is that Ramachandran, like C.V. Raman, had this tradition of always publishing top class, very important work in Indian journals like Current Science, and he also published it in Nature. So he always had a habit of publishing in Indian journals top class novel path breaking work and another version of it in the outside journals. So, and then our current understanding of collagen is such that we have these amino acids from the tropocollagen, which make these fibrils and make these bigger fibers. And you can see again David Kutzer's beautiful diagram showing how the collagens are all a mesh, which gives you the strength of the cells and the ligaments. Incidentally, collagen is the highest amount or most abundant in all mammals, protein in all mammals. It's about 30% which is found in humans, protein is there everywhere, in your skin, in your gut, in your cornea, ligament. So Ramachandran and workers managed to solve the structure of the most abundant protein in the mammalian kingdom, and a protein which is present everywhere, without which you are literally a bag of, we are literally a bag of molecules. And it is this that Ramachandran did, and then he didn't stop there. What did they do next? They went about a systematic work. We said, because when they published this, Rich and Crick made a comment on their paper saying that, look, these fellows from India, they published it, but it's all wrong. You know, they've got these atoms which are too close, which doesn't happen like this. It cannot be correct. So Ramachandran, instead of going into polemical about this, he took his band of workers, namely Sashekaran and Ramakrishnan, and got them to look at systematically all the crystal structures which are available with them. They found that atoms come closer than what was normally seen at that time. These they called as the allowed contact distance. The allowed contact distance is about 10% smaller or shorter than what people used to observe at that point of time. So in fact, their proposal was validated. And then they went on to say that what shapes can I generate for proteins? For that, they defined two bonds, one which you see here between the blue atom and the black atom, the nitrogen and the carbon, called the phi rotation, and another which you see between the carbon and this carbon, called the psi rotation. So along the main chain or backbone of the peptide protein, they defined these two rotations and said, by doing these two rotations, you can generate various shapes of the proteins. So the next logical thing was to combine the two. And they said, you generate these various ones, and if any structure comes into a clash or atom comes into clash with another, then you reject that structure. So what they did is that they then put this in a grid and put one rotation on one side, another rotation on this side, and said, look, if in this particular combination of rotations, what happens is you can see that this, the side chain carbon atom comes into a clash with the oxygen atom here. So that is a short contact, so this is not allowed. Whereas here, this side chain carbon is far away from the nitrogen here, or this side chain carbon is far away from this atom here. So it's allowed. So then they constructed a map. Later on, it has been called the Ramachandran plot, which showed that which are the structures or conformations which are allowed and which are not allowed. And at the time Ramachandran did this work, there were only two structures, myoglobin and hemoglobin, which had just been published, but whose coordinates are really not available with them. So they had no way to use this plot to check whether structures are allowed or disallowed. Subsequently, people have shown that if you take any protein structure, and if you take all the amino acid residues, take their phi and psi values, and plot it in this Ramachandran plot, then a structure which has good quality comes like this. A structure which has bad quality is scattered all over, meaning even in the disallowed regions, you find residue positions. Whereas in the good quality structure, all of them are within the allowed region. So it has become a touchstone to check and validate structures now. So we just move on to the crystal structures. First is a myoglobin. We saw myoglobin structure was the first one to be done by Perutz and Kendrew, for which they got the Nobel Prize. And what you see here is this ring atom, the heme with the iron in the middle, and the myoglobin out here. And this is another version of the space filling model, which shows that this is the protein, this is a heme ion part. And you can see shyly peeping out the oxygen that is bound in the center of the heme. So what do you do when you get structures like this? You can make structures of many different, the same molecule from many different organisms. So I take myoglobin from various different organisms, and structures are made. So, and then you can compare them, just as I can compare features of people and say, okay, maybe these two are closely related, maybe they are distantly related to somebody else by looking at the facial features, and if you look at the comparison. Same way, you can compare molecular structures and say whether they are closely or distantly related, and you can see that horse and sperm whale myoglobin are closer to each other than they are to human, and human, horse and sperm whale are closer than they are to sea turtle, and so on. This also explains, you can also use the differences, for example, in sperm whale to explain how sperm whale myoglobin, normally myoglobin is a protein that binds oxygen and gives oxygen to the tissues, muscles. In sperm whale, it's much more needed than in humans, and how that functions has also been explained. And this is a structure of hemoglobin, where four units are there. And hemoglobin, as I told you, binds oxygen and releases it. Just as a GIF to show you how it's doing that, you can see the oxygen going in and out, binding here. And you can see the rest of the protein moving. That is what is beauty about the protein structures, that they are not rigid things, which as we see in the diagrams. They are flexible, they breathe, they move. And it is this movement that allows them to function very well. And insulin is structure which I told you about. Here just to show you that you can use structure to get a lot of meaningful information. And insulin is stored as 6 units together, but they function, if you put the insulin in water, it dissociates into monomers, single molecules, and they only function. So if you can find a way to keep the insulins from being together all the time but quickly moving away, then it will work faster. And that's what has been done. People have put engineered the protein, because you can use genetic engineering to engineer your protein and make new protein molecules. So here the protein has been engineered to put a negative charge residue here, so that when they come together in the 6-mer, this residue sees the neighboring negative residue and say, I don't like you, and moves away. And so it goes as a monomer quickly. In the other case, they put tails, carbon tails here. These carbon tails go and latch onto the nearby ones. So it's like in a party, you go and the guy keeps on shaking your hand, and it's very difficult to move when you want to move away. No, ultimately you do move away. Something similar happens. This insulin takes a little longer to move away, and so it's slow acting. And both these are being cleared by the FDA and are available in the market. From January 2016, the slow acting one is available, and from 2014, the other one is available. So you see, knowing molecular structural information can give you a handle on doing a lot of other things about understanding the protein as well as making use of it further. So it doesn't happen only all over the world. It happens right here, right next door in the Madras University, where J.N. Ramachandran did his work. There's now also very enthusiastic groups. This group is by Karthi and Anuradha. They have determined the first time a crystal structure whose the protein was crystallized 83 years ago. This Jagbeen urease was crystallized 83 years ago. That is the first protein to be crystallized. But people couldn't determine the structure because it was not diffracting properly. They managed to get pure protein, do this, and get the structure. So work is going on everywhere, especially all over the country. Structural biology you will find happening in all major institutes and major universities. And that is a legacy from G.N. Ramachandran, who started a group here, moved on, and Institute of Science Bangalore, MBU, he started another group. All the structural biology that is going on is literally a product of these groups which have come about. And structural biology has put the whole of crystallography or macromolecular structural part in the face of the world. And then I will move on to a bit of a commercial break. And this is the first membrane protein structure which was determined in the country, and that is done from my group in Madurai, where we started working in 95, 17 years ago on membrane proteins. And that work was done by Arogyaswamy, who was a student at that time who initiated. He went on to do a postdoctoral work, and is now in ICGB Delhi doing work on membrane proteins from MTB. Actually, now he's right there at the corner, right? So he happens to have come here. And this structure of OMPEF was done by Balasubramaniam, who is doing a postdoctoral in Germany, and who fortunately also happens to be just behind in the row there. So Balu and Arogyaswamy, these are the two guys who got us our first membrane structure. Give them a hand, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. So now you see, if you take this all the membrane protein structures or other structures, you find that there are about 120,000 structures. And these 120,000 structures, all of them, whether they are complex or not, follow the Ramachandran plot. If the structure doesn't follow the Ramachandran plot, the protein data bank will not accept the coordinate for deposition. Again, the protein data bank is a wonderful invention in the 70s, where all structures of macromolecules which are determined by the community, whether it is funded privately or publicly, if it is going to be published, it has to be deposited there. Right? So this is a wonderful open resource, started long before open resource became a fashionable word. And this, just to come back to GNR, GNR not only did such things of structure of collagen or the Ramachandran plot, he also inspired a lot of people. For example, Venkatachalam, he was a mathematician working with GNR, who got inspired by GNR to look at the patterns in protein structures and came up with this beta turn, which is sort of ubiquitous now in protein structures. There is no protein structure without a beta turn almost. And that is work by Venkatachalam. Again, you see, Venkatachalam published it as a single author, though he worked with GNR. And same thing happened with GNR also. GNR has no joint publication with Raman, even though he was a student of Raman. Raman, because GNR's work was also original, Raman let GNR publish all his work on his own name. So GNR did this, and he also made Madras the place where the scientific world came to the feet of Madras. And you can see every year almost he used to organize conferences, and for these conferences people all over the world, scientists, top rate scientists, felt it a privilege and an honor to be invited by GNR Ramachandran's group, and they used to flock here. You have here GNR with his wife Rajam, and this is Dorothy Hodgkin with Paul Dirac and Linus Pauling, and there are many more people who have come. So in 2001, GNR passed away in Chennai, and many people wrote many things about him, but the best, in my opinion, is what D. Balasubramanian wrote in The Hindu about the prize that missed the master. Ramachandran, as he says, is the equivalent of Einstein, Newton, or Crick. He came up with three independent original ideas. If somebody had been counting, they would have said only two. It's collagen and the Ramachandran plot. Where is the third? The third happens to be something which is not in the molecular realm. In the 70s, he and Lakshmi Narayan came up with a method to convert two-dimensional images into three-dimensional images. This he published in the Proceedings of Indian Academy of Science and the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. And then he tried to find, it is told, funding to construct something which will do this practically. He didn't get the funding. But a few years later, the computer tomography, CT scan, was made in a similar manner, and subsequently the MRI machine, which also uses similar algorithms, was developed. MRI, the person who people who developed MRI, Lodberg and Mansfield, they got the Nobel Prize. And in the Nobel lecture of Mansfield, he mentions, he gives reference to GNR's work about the method which he developed. So it's not that with the passing away of GNR, things have changed. It's there. It's just that we need more people. There are lots of data, biological data being generated, but what we lack, what GN Ramachandran and others showed, is the questions are what is important. No, this Ramachandran plot, he came up with the allowed distances. Pauling is supposed to have remarked, we had the same sort of peptide crystal structures, but we didn't find the allowed distances. We didn't look for it. We didn't ask the right question. So what is important in biology is to ask the right question, and this is sorely lacking. For this, we need young minds, young bodies, young spirited people who can come and join the world of molecules and ask the right questions and work with passion to get more and more such things done. And you can see here, this Ramachandran has many tributes to him, but I find in Chennai, the best tribute is what is a triple helix auditorium in CLRA that was started. It's really an honor to this person. And then of course, in IBAB Bangalore, they have named an avenue after GN Ramachandran. And this is something which the students of the Department of Crystallography made in his honor. So thank you all.
Thank you so much for a nice talk about Madras, about so many things from Madras. We do have a few questions for you. I think one of them you answered. The first question from Tamar Kumaran was, why did GNR not get the Nobel Prize? Or let me rephrase that. I think you said as much without saying too much. Do you think his work was recognized in other ways?
Yes, G.N. Ramachandran, you know, as you said, it is the Nobel Prize that suffers by not having his name in it. And Ramachandran has been recognized in a variety of ways. And it's also an important mark. So Ramachandran didn't work for getting any honors. In fact, he is one person who never lobbied for anything, never tried to get anything done. He just did his work and he is happy with the work he did. And that's the sort of people he also inspired. So I think it's important science is recognized for the science rather than for the awards and honors that are coming with it.
Okay, before I ask you some more questions, may I ask the other speakers to come up on stage for some more questions? Here's another question from Lingesh Raja on Facebook. He asks, suppose there were life on another planet, or an exoplanet, could it be made with other elements without hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen?
Yeah, actually this, just while I was preparing for the talk, that I happened to talk to Indumati, I don't know if she's around. But that's when I realized, because at that time I didn't realize why hydrogen, carbon, oxygen are so much present in biological systems and they are so dominant on Earth. Apparently the way the formation of the Earth happens that since these are the elements that are closest which are there, I don't remember the arguments fully, but I understood that if any other planet was to be formed, which is about the same distance from the sun and so on, they would have a similar composition of elements which are present. So in which case the dominant elements would naturally come in for biological life.
So here's another question from SMS. Could biological molecules be based on silicon instead of carbon?
Yeah, in principle, yes, because silicon is tetrahedral, carbon is tetrahedral, but as silicon is much further down, and I think you will not get so much silicon being available. In the Earth's crust, it is there, but silicon-based life has been proposed, but it doesn't exist. Yeah.
So there's one question from Manikandan on Facebook. He asks, can you explain the difficulties in understanding protein folding? So if I understand right, many of the things you talked about were about the structure of the protein itself, but then there are deeper issues about how the protein molecule is folded.
That's what I was saying, that we need more people to ask the questions. Protein folding is a problem which has been, as Amri said, I know it was there in the $1 million thing, but it should be there. No? Protein folding is a very difficult point to understand. We still do not understand it fully, and it's an open question.
Thank you. Thank you so much.